Hey, it's Carl from Smallstep, and today I want to talk about a few different ways that private encryption keys can be stored and used by applications today. So, asymmetric crypto is great because private keys can be separated from public keys and they can be stored separately. And so, you might store a root certificate authority private key offline in a safe and distribute the public key to many clients, right? This is great because you have this physical security around the root CA key, and if you ever need to sign a new intermediate CA, you have to go into the safe and get the root CA out. As long as that's the only copy of the private key, you know there's this physical security around it, and that's very helpful. But what about online private key material? A lot of applications need to use private keys all the time. So how and where should these private keys be stored and how should they be used? And I want to go over four different options for storing and using private encryption keys. Like many things in engineering, it depends. You know, there's different approaches. Generally speaking, private key material should be moved around as little as possible, because every time you move a private key, you open up opportunities for it to be stolen. So public key infrastructure uses a lot of mechanisms, things like certificate signing requests, that make it possible for private keys to remain where they're generated. So that's just kind of a rule of thumb. Now let's look at some options for doing this. So I want to talk about storing keys on disk, storing keys in a cloud key manager or cloud KMS, storing keys in a TPM or Secure Enclave or other trusted execution environment, and storing keys in an HSM. So the simplest option is to just store the private key on disk on the same system that's going to use it. And it's definitely the easiest approach when it comes to developing an application that's going to use a private key, because you can just read the key off the, you know, out of the file off the disk. And it's probably going to be encrypted. So there'll be an encryption password that needs to be stored somewhere else. It's a straightforward option, but it's also the least secure option. And it's got a big downside, which is that a lot of applications today are built at a scale where, you know, they require the key to be available to many different systems. A second option is to store the private keys in a cloud key manager. So something like HashiCorp Vault or Azure Key Vault, Google Cloud KMS. And this is a common way to store keys today, whether they're asymmetric private keys or API keys or anything else. So then in this case, when a virtual machine or a Kubernetes pod starts up and needs that key, it can just fetch the key out of Cloud KMS, put it in an environment variable, use it at runtime. And in this case, you have some more protection around the keys, but you also added this service dependency. So there's a trade-off there. A more secure version of this option would be to integrate the key manager with the application that needs the key. So you don't have to like ever copy the private key material out of the key manager. There's really only a few cryptographic operations that asymmetric private keys are used for. And so if your application could use the key manager's API and have the key manager perform those operations and get back a response, then it never needs to access the original key. There's a downside to this, though, which is that a lot of applications, there's a potential latency issue. Like if you're needing to run a cryptographic operation on every new TLS connection that you're making from your application, you don't want to have to call an API to do that. It's much like lower latency and simpler if you have the private key in memory and you can run the cryptographic operation on it just directly. So definitely a downside to using a key manager like that. A third option would be to use a TPM, a trusted platform module, or a YubiKey or a secure enclave, or another trusted execution environment, a TEE, that's strictly isolated from the CPU. And I'm going to oversimplify here, but generally any of these, a TPM, YubiKey, these are cryptographic processors. They're like used to store private keys, and they're very well isolated. And they have different levels of functionality and different amounts of processing power. These are great for end user applications on mobile devices and laptops in particular. So when you use Touch ID on a Mac or Face ID, your fingerprints are stored in the secure enclave and they can't be exported. So the idea here is that you generate private keys of some sort inside the cryptographic processor, and the key will never leave. And an application can then use those keys to perform cryptographic operations also inside that processor, but the keys can't be exported. So these are called hardware-bound or device-bound keys. And this is an option. It's a lot more secure than using a key manager or a file-based key, but it's important to note that the key can't ever leave the device. So you can't copy the key to another machine, and your application also has to have support for using a TPM or YubiKey or secure enclave written into it, right? So TPMs have a standard interface for this, the TPM2 standard, and there's like libraries you can use to integrate TPM operations into your application. Apple also has a standard interface for generating and using keys that are stored in the secure enclave. And what's nice about this approach is that in a sense, your device, each device is the key. And so it's a little bit more analogous to like having a physical key. And that makes it easier to reason about endpoint security when you have these hardware-bound keys. And so Smallstep's app uses hardware-bound keys heavily. And I hope we'll see a lot more applications add support for them. And while I'm on this topic and we're talking about TPMs, there's a few different kinds of TPMs, and I think it's worth kind of breaking down, like describing each one, because they have different security characteristics. So I want to talk about three different kinds of TPMs, little sidebar here. A discrete TPM is, you know, when you think of a TPM, like this is a chip, right? This is an actual TPM chip that gets installed on the device. You can buy them on Amazon. And a discrete TPM is kind of a similar level of key protection to a YubiKey because they are tamper resistant. So trying to export a private key from a discrete TPM is almost impossible. You'd need like a lot of really expensive equipment, and you'd probably have to destroy the TPM, and it's probably not worth it. Another type of TPM is the firmware TPM. And this is like a TPM emulator that's written into the UEFI firmware of a device. And these can also support hardware-bound keys, but they don't have the same sort of tamper resistance as a discrete TPM. So it may be a little easier to extract the keys from a firmware TPM, but it's probably still very difficult. It kind of depends on the security of UEFI platform and stuff like that. So it's not as isolated on both the software and hardware level as a discrete TPM. And then finally, the virtual TPMs are kind of like a way of offering the same TPM 2.0 compliant interface to virtual machines that you would get on a discrete TPM on bare metal. So when, if you think of like a physical device in a data center, it's going to run 20 or 30 virtual machines at once. It can't use a single discrete TPM to serve all of those. So this is just an emulated TPM that's emulated by the hypervisor, by the virtualization software. It's also like a little bit of a different set of requirements when you're in the context of a data center. Like, having a tamper-resistant TPM is maybe not as important in that context because the data center was already going to have so much physical security compared to my iPhone. So instead, what you really want is isolation between the TPMs on the different virtual machines on that device, right? So the virtualization software for a virtual TPM creates and emulates a soft TPM for each virtual machine. And from each VM standpoint, it looks like a discrete TPM. Looks like that device has a discrete TPM. But each of those virtual TPMs are, each on all those private keys are strongly isolated from each other by the hypervisor. It's important to note, though, with virtual TPMs that the keys are not hardware bound, usually. There are different approaches for handling them, but they're typically not hardware bound. For example, GCP encrypts them and stores them into a database, and you can even, as a customer, request that database and get that data back out. So finally, that's kind of end of sidebar about different kinds of TPMs and how and what their security characteristics are. The fourth option for storing private keys that I wanted to talk about was hardware security modules. You can think of an HSM as almost like a beefier version of a TPM. If you have an application that needs like really high volume cryptographic operations and you want hardware bound keys, that's where an HSM can be really useful. They usually can handle a lot of keys and a lot of operations. They're either like an external hardware device or they're like PCIe, like plug-in cards. And they're often used in high security, high volume contexts like financial institutions. And yeah, HSMs is kind of like the best of all worlds for storing private keys, but they're also very expensive. All right, I hope this video was helpful, and let me know in the comments if you have any questions about storing private keys. Thanks.